being a blood because your brother a blood or a pyro, that ain't the original shit. So if you ain't going by original protocol, you ain't no original gangster. You ain't no original gangster, you ain't no gangster. You ain't no gangster, stop claiming Su Wu. That's our shit, me and my homie shit. Me and my big homie shit. My dead homie shit. You motherfuckers wanna get some type of respect, start fucking with the bloods that y'all supposed to fuck with, not the bloods that y'all wanna fuck with. This ain't y'all shit.
The sitting is the world famous one way. The homies banked up, meeting up on a Sunday. Run across the street just to get some bruising. Shh. What do you know? A crab slipping wearing flu and shh. I take the flags out my pocket, wrap it around my knuckles, make a fist, then lock it. Deposit a blow to the jaw as I bank 'em. Break a phony on top of the counter, then I shank 'em. It's the Pyro, the G's with the rhymes. Four clips, shot crabs 8 times with the knot. I got love from the west side, straight to the east side. Ricketts and Bloods, both bump the east side. Fuck in your trunk is the bomb set. Trip, I pull the pin and light it up like Vietnam. Pimps in red uniform, storming crab sets. And I bet from here on out we get some more respect. Shouts to the Swans, V&G's, Lanes and Dubs. Red rum with the Avenue Pyro love.
I hear what you're saying, so okay. that's the thing that got me on, like, wait a minute, I see what it is. So it's like,
because as far as in me, I'm not speaking as far as in me,
yeah,
you know what I'm saying? I'm talking about, like, I see homegirls that I see out there working, you know, and they struggling like a mug, and then it's the same clique of guys that went to school and they like in the same grades, and it's like they own the videos and all, they on stage and all this all type of stuff, but these niggas is lean heads, you know what I'm saying? And they not doing nothing for really nobody, but then you got these chicks that the same people you was in the same classrooms with, and they trying to drive buses or whatever the case may be, and they solid. They got hands like a motherfucker too, but you're not reaching out to them. What you do is you come to the hood maybe once a year, and that ain't even a solid. And mama, get backpacks.
Mama,
and I think that we need to not do that.
Mama, we can't. Look, y'all. We're going to take a lunch break real quick. We're going to take like a little 15-minute bathroom break. We're going to let her calm down.
I'm just
her thermostat
saying.
Is up.
I'm
like, we're going to get her some antifreeze real quick. Look. Mama.
So I'm just saying, because my thing is with the teen girls and the young women, you know, and I'm just trying to get as much help and as much awareness out there to help them as well, because they're the ones that have the kids. You know what I'm saying? I'm not saying that every young mom is a good one. I'm not saying every young mom is a bad mom, but start reaching out to them. You know what I'm saying? I mean, okay, the backpack giveaway, that's cool, but put one of them on the payroll, and I'm pretty sure she'd be solid, if not more loyal than some of these niggas you got on payroll, because she got these kids to maintain. I'm just bringing awareness to that, basically.
Okay, so let me,
because I'm going to pay my own ways. I don't need nobody to come put me on nothing.
Hold on.
So I'm not speaking for me.
Hold on.
Boom.
Right. I'm having an idea. Okay. So, why don't you know? You know, like a talent agency is, right?
Yeah.
So job placement agency.
Uh-huh.
Why don't you like you talk to some of these moms, find out what they do and what they want to do. You keep the information, and then like when you interview motherfuckers or you meet motherfuckers, you'll be able to provide services or the type of connection from what you need, like a braider, like you do, and then that way you can.
No, I'm already on that.
Okay, well, excuse me. I ain't come for your shit to know.
I'm already on
you
that.
Boot me? Okay. Now, watch. Ask me some bitches to watch me go in on somebody since you want to boot me. You're going to make your shit hot.
Scared.
Oh, okay. You want to play the pooka? All right, but what's up, though?
So, but that's just, you know, that's just one of my things. I just be saying, like, us women, especially African-American women, is either we battling with each other. You know what I'm saying, on the bullshit, and then it's like the guys that do make it big, they don't reach back to us. You know what I'm saying? I'm just saying from my era, my section. That's all I'm saying from. But I do on different levels understand why they don't. You know what I'm saying? But then again, there are at least 2 or 3 you went to school with that's solid. And the only thing she needs is you to help her, and she finna really go. She finna go smash harder than some of these niggas that be half-ass high all goddamn day. So I'm just bringing awareness to that. You know what I'm saying? Because the change, the environment, the change was going on, you have to start somewhere. And I believe starting with the women is a major factor.
It is.
And with women starting with themselves is the top of the charts.
true, but like the nature of the beast is women support women and men support men. And but that's what the nature of the beast is, unless you're in a relationship with that female or unless you're a family member of that female. So, I mean, that's just the nature of the beast. That's why it's girl power. That's why it's the brotherhood. That's why it's separation, because we're supposed to support each other. Like, when a man and a woman, you know, get into a situation, who can he go vent to? Like, it's females he can vent to, but it's also motherfucker, and he feel more comfortable explaining that shit to his brother or to, like, you know, like,
yeah,
I said,
depending on the situation.
Depending
right.
on the situation. So, the nature of the beast is women support women and men support men. The interaction is tolerable, but at the end of the day, that's what it is. Because when a man don't financially support a woman in her dream or what she want to do, who's going to be there to motherfucking tell her, bitch, you can do that shit, fuck him? Another motherfucking female. So she's still offering some type of support, even though I'm not saying that that's the support that the woman in question needs. She still gets support from a woman. Like, it's variations where, like, you know, her best friend might be a dude. It might be some type of connection there later on down the road. Or the dude that she talked to might be a fag, or, excuse me, homosexual. So she can communicate with him and he can understand. But at the end of the day, the nature of the beast is she support her and he support him. It's, but motherfuckers will come to an agreement depending on what it is. Like if their friendship is strong enough, he gonna support her. She gonna support him. He gonna support her. Or either way it goes.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? It go both ways. Which it has go both ways, because this is life.
Right.
All right, now. But just everybody doing it, it's not common. It's not common. Like, even, like, in relationship-wise, like a man motherfucking put a woman through school, like, and a woman put a man through school, like, nigga, you forever owe her, or she forever owe you. Like you supported that dream. Now it's a living dream. This is what I do. This is what I do.
And it's supposed to be like that, though. Like, that's that good shit.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? But people misconstrued it and then turn around and build anger about it or some type of way. But that's, you're supposed to. You know what I'm saying? Like, if it's a relationship or if it's just a platonic relationship, it's supposed to be like that. You know, help each other. Help, you know, your brother. Help your sister. It's supposed to be like that. But it's been fucked up and misconstrued down the line where it's like, it's a negative look at, I ain't gonna do that for her because, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it's like that's stupid. That's stupid as fuck.
You know what people don't, yeah, I'm gonna tell you why. People don't want to get played.
I understand that.
And
that's, a lot of people play too much.
Play too much, and some motherfuckers
and
be
not
like,
serious.
Are you play me?
I'ma hurt you.
I'ma hurt you.
And all your family. I know.
So it's like that right there is one of the biggest blocks in
helping.
Like this motherfucker. But then it's like, okay, if I help him now, I might, you know what I'm saying? You might, as you see this person progressing, you might start developing feelings for this motherfucker. And but then the added incentive is, I invested all this money in you, and like, now I'm developing feelings for you, and you don't want to fuck with me?
Yeah, it comes with a
See,
lot.
That's what I'm saying. It's potholes in that trip, in that journey. It's potholes, it's speed bumps, it's jump ramps.
Right.
It's all kind of shit. Like, it's boulders rolling down off the side. You got to swerve. So it's like, people, at the end of the day, people don't want to get played, and women support women, and men support men. And that's just the nature of the beast. That's all. That's what I see, even though I know that it's not supposed to just be like that. I know,
right.
And like, to be human and in humanity is like, you have to be more flexible. But then at the same time, look, we black. Well, we're African American. In other cultures, we don't know how the fuck they getting on and doing what they doing, because them motherfuckers,
they not gonna tell us.
They flourishing like a motherfucker. You think they not investing in each other or
but
with each other?
But the thing about it is certain people that do know how to do what they do, and they're not gonna share it.
See, we can't focus on them. You wanna know why?
Why?
That's they karma. That's they fucked up shit.
Well, yeah, of course.
Then
of
that's
course.
Why.
But it's one of those things where we have the other races, they help each other. You know?
But that's always been. Like, that's this look, what we going through now ain't nothing new. It's just our time and technology is up to speed. And we seeing more. So much shit that we don't see, that nigga, me and that mama, that the shit is ridiculous. We could be talking about a topic. But that topic, the shit that's going on, could only be going on within our age group.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? Our time frame. So that don't mean that it's not going on. Like, motherfuckers, they was doing it. They just skipped over our generation, or our generation not doing it. Or that's a practice that we forgot. It's like the G code and the protocol has been forgotten. It's the same fucking shit in life, in relationship. Being a human, it's the same shit. It's the same shit. So everything is not going to be remembered. Everything is not going to be practiced. It's just we have to pick the things that are necessities and push on those protocols and G codes. This what the fuck is supposed to be. We need to bring that back. We need to find a way to bring that back. But we can't waste too much time and energy on some shit that don't look like not enough people is investing in. Like, if you're the only one that you know going for it, or you like one in 20 people, like 20 people you know going for it, okay, is everybody pushing? Everybody got the same passion? Like is it really worth it? If it's not really worth it, that's one of the things that you gotta stay hold to you. This is one of my principles. If everybody don't wanna do it, this is my principle.
Right.
But this is supposed to be a general principle. But if everybody don't wanna do it, this is how I'm gonna live my motherfucking life. That way I know my karma be good, because this is my energy. This is what I wanna do. This is what I'm gonna do. Y'all ain't wanna do it, okay. I'm gonna pick somebody that deserves me helping them, and I'm gonna motherfucking help their motherfucking ass. Mm-hmm. You motherfuckers ain't gotta do it, okay. You have to deprive them. Don't worry about it. When this person become who they wanna be, and I get blessed, even if I don't get blessed, I know for myself, I know what I did.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right. So if they bless me, like, and they blow up, come on so I can put you on my chairman board. Mm-hmm. Come here, let me give you this stock. Come here, you need your hair done? Appointment, whenever. Anything.
Anything.
You
right.
get blessed later on in your motherfucking life. Right. You ain't got to worry about them. You didn't want to do it?
Oh, well.
I'm
going to get mine.
So don't. The thing is, don't worry about too much. Don't put too much energy on it, because people gonna do what the fuck they wanna do.
Yeah, regardless, I'm just shining a light on it.
Yeah,
I ain't heard,
right.
It's a few things that I haven't heard people touch on, and I'm touching.
Oh, molester?
Yes.
Nah.
Yes, okay, I'm taking that, taking that.
All right, what? Let's go somewhere else. Come on, that's another question I'm looking right at.
No, we done with it.
Oh, well, freestyle some shit then. I ain't finished.
I think Sid trying to come on. You can pause it.
No, let her on camera.
I mean, I'll pause it right quick.
It's crazy. I want her to be freak. Look, she y'all, this should be natural.
It's not live action. Okay, so with the begging on wax and everything, out of all the Bloods and Crips that participated, approximately how many are still alive? That was a lot of people.
I mean, we didn't lose that many. So I'm trying. I can name the ones that we lost easier than I can remember the ones that's still here. Like off the Blood side, we lost Mad Eye, Tiptoe, Spider, Peanut, B Braze, Bloody Mary, Lil Hawk Got Life, Green Eyes. He passed away. I think that's all the Bloods. Yeah, I think that's all the Bloods, if I'm not mistaken. Then the Crips, we lost Freeze, AWOL, Folk Clips, Tweety Bird. We lost Ronnie Ron, bitch ass. Those are like the main ones that I remember. Everybody else is pretty much still alive, you know, living their life.
And that sounds, them names sound like them like was major ones though.
Yeah, like, you know, like that's over the whole span of the whole collection. Bangin' on Wax 1, Bangin' on Wax 2, Domo Rogers 1, Domo Rogers 2. I was also on Rep Your Set. We lost a few from there. Big Ben from Pueblos, Tanik from Swans. Damn.
Well, you're knocking down numbers with the names.
Yeah, but it's more alive than it is passed away.
Okay, good.
You know what I'm saying? So, like I said, over the span of all of those albums, like, I named probably like around 9 or 10 Bloods. I named like around 5 Crips. five, you know, so it's like out of all those albums, you know, it's still had numbers, we still got out of all those albums, there's quite a few people participated on it. Jay Stank, he was a producer from Bangin' on Wax.
Okay.
Yeah. Mike from Wreck Your Set, he was from Bounty Hunters. Yeah, man. So my whole career, my whole gangbang career, I've been losing homies.
Yeah, that comes with the territory, sadly to say.
Yeah, that's why I'm kind of numb. You know, like, I'm not saying it don't hurt. I'm just, like, numb to it. That's why, like, it's kind of easy for me to go document the funerals and go film them and stuff. Because, I've been to so many throughout my years that, like, it don't... No, I'm not saying that their death don't bother me. I'm just saying that it don't bother me. Death don't bother me like that. And like funerals don't bother me. Like that's what being desensitized does. That's exactly what being desensitized does. It means that you have no feeling. You don't feel the shit. That's what TV programming does to kids. They see so much bullshit on TV that when they see it in real life, it don't mean nothing.
Right, but that's like trauma, you know, because the body and the mind is supposed to feel some type of way about different things. But after you going through it and going through it, it kind of numbs you out, as you say. But that's not good.
I mean, why not? Because I'm not saying that I don't feel bad that they're not here no more. It's just that, like, this is a part of life. Death is a part of life. So why is it that I can accept a lot of things and not accept that this part of life has finally gotten here?
Right. I mean, I understand what you're saying exactly. But it's like how our environment is that have us numb to something like that, which is not natural for us to even be numb to things like that, is what I mean by that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Not that it's not affecting you or nothing like that, but just by us in our community seeing this so often that we became numb to certain things, that's like not natural.
Yeah, but I mean, in life, I didn't mean just, I didn't mean just the gangbanging stuff. But I'm saying I've been through it. I've had homies that rap that didn't gangbang that lost their life. I have, you know, just people that's not even associated with rap and gangbang. I've been from the time I was born to the time I am now, just like you, just like Beyonce, just like Auntie back here, from as far back as we went. How old was you when you went to your first funeral, Auntie? See? What about you? How old was you?
Depending on what type of funeral, but I would say...
No, just a funeral.
I don't know, I was about 7 or something.
How old was you when you went to your first funeral?
Like
17. 17?
Yeah, I didn't. No,
family member.
Who funeral did you go to?
What's her name?
Oh, that was a family member of mine. Yeah.
Okay. See, I mean, like for us, damn it, like more than half our life. You said 7, right?
Mm-hmm, that was some, but that was a church.
It's
still a funeral. It's a funeral, right?
Which means your whole life, starting at 7, you've been losing people.
Mm-hmm. That I can recollect, yeah.
So it's like
before then, because I was in church, so yeah.
So to a certain extent, you desensitized to funerals and death, depending on who it is. The closer that the person is to you, you're gonna feel the most.
Of course.
So the person that's farthest from you, what you gonna feel? Like you might say, like, that's fucked up.
Yeah, but that's what I'm gonna feel.
But that's temporary, because you're not gonna remember. Like, it's not gonna bother you no more.
Right.
So it's like, to a certain level, depending on how close you were to these people, depending on how close you were to the situation, you're gonna be desensitized one way or the other. If you right there on the spot, that's more like trauma. When you got shot with the same bullet, that's more like trauma. But desensitization is, it happens to everybody, and it's not labeled as trauma if, depending on the relation to the person that you had or to the direct correlation to the incident. So it's different levels to it.
It's different levels to it, but with what I'm meaning by it.
Come on.
Different type of environment is a different type of death. You get what I'm saying? It may be a car accident or something like that.
Different environment.
Yeah, like the white people, they not going through what we barely are. They not having funerals like the kids is getting killed out there on the street and on the lawn. Versus,
how they
say, I don't know, drugs,
exactly,
maybe drugs.
Exactly.
Exactly, but what I'm saying is, it's different where it's a lot of shootings within your neighborhood throughout the week, and you're seeing people just die like that. That's what I mean.
The frequency of it?
The frequency and the traumatization of it. But that's the difference.
That's what I'm saying. The traumatization part you're talking about that I just broke down, like I just broke down to you, is the connection to the person that you have, or the if you was on scene, because the more trauma consists of seeing shit,
And feeling at the same time,
or feeling
or
the shit,
disbelief, or whatever case may be.
So if it's happening in the hood,
or whatever,
and we all like, damn, as opposed to a white person in Bel Air, they coming home, and they seeing their son overdose, or they hear their son overdose at a party, they gonna feel some type of trauma, but they're not gonna feel what we saw them at the home, the little boy on the thing with his brains blown out, or the pregnant lady in the store shot in the stomach because somebody robbed. That's different, as opposed to the pain that they feel.
Of course, it's different,
so different
because different levels, and because the numbers are not as high as ours,
right? And
so that's how we get to the point where we numbing things out, because it's like, shit, next week something else gonna happen.
But it also consists of if you are there when it happens. All right, the time span, which is the frequency, how many times it happens. Add that with the people that's there, or the person that's there on the scene when it happened, and seeing a brain blown out. If them white people not seeing it happen, if it's not happening as often, and if they're not on the scene when it happened, their trauma is going to be different than ours. Ours is going to always be greater because that's our community. So you might hear that somebody got shot at the store. You might not know that person. How, on a scale from 1 to 10, what is your reaction going to be?
On a scale from 1 to 10? It may be like a 2 or 3, like, damn, that's fucked up.
Okay, that's fucked up. How long do you think that's fucked up is going to last in your mind?
Every time I hear about it, but it ain't going to penetrate and be on my mind like that all day. All
right, so now apply that same formula to them white people that's happening in their neighborhood, but not as much. They're going to be like, Brad died? What happened to him? The same reaction, the same 2% that is going to be for you is going to be for them. Now, if you're in the hood and you see this person shot and fucked up, how long is that going to last with you?
Forever.
But that's what I'm saying. That on the scene seeing shit matched with it happening again a week and a half later. If you keep on going through that motherfucking thing, that's going to fuck you up. It's going to fuck you up. If they, like you said, if they don't go through it as much, mm-hmm. you're not going to go through it as much. But if they seeing the shit like, damn, I just saw somebody, I just saw Brad. Now, Mark, if they, them white people, if they keep on going through that shit, they're going to be just as fucked up as we are.
Yeah, that's the difference of why they're not.
Why? That's exactly why. But it'd be them that make the motherfucking crazy ass killing movies. It'd be them that make the motherfucking, it'd be them that make the motherfucking movies, and we got to live this shit. That's just like video games. They say, okay, well, the neighborhoods are bad. We can't, we got to clean up the parks. We got to clean up the street. Them damn gangbangers out there selling dope and pimping and prostituting and robbing cars. And then now everybody in the black community is labeled as, they label, the gang members are bad, this, this, and that. They wipe us out, put us in prison. They making all the money out of us in jail and prison. But then they got these video game companies that sit down and make the video games of us doing the same fucking shit, that we can create characters of the same homies that just got locked up and went to the prison, and they making money off of that. See, those video games are simulations. Simulations are nothing but training exercises. So because they can't go outside and learn how to do this shit, where are they learning how to do this shit? In the fucking house. So I'm finna go out here and buy this motherfucking video game, which is a manual, to teach my kids how to play this fucking video game, so whenever they start wanting to rebel and act up at a certain age, they already got in their mind how to do this shit, because I bought the motherfucking, it's all programming.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not going to keep playing word games with Red Rum, because I swear he worded me around the mulberry bush, you guys.
She got a track shoe, y'all. She ready.
Yes, yes. So with that being said, I think that's about it. Anything you want to say to the young guys out there that's up and coming rappers, as far as in anything you want to put out there?
Okay, look. Some of y'all have kids and some of y'all don't. Imagine This goes for some of the upcoming rappers, kids, people that want to rap, and some of you rappers that's already in the industry. Imagine narrating your songs to your kids. Imagine breaking down the shit that you say to your children. Imagine doing that. Imagine being responsible and being held accountable for what you're saying, because no matter how long you're in the limelight, you're still a role model. So imagine breaking down, selling lean, percocetting your blood to your kids. Yeah, so that, what do that mean, Daddy? Oh, I was taking drugs. Oh, you're not going to tell your kids that. Imagine talking about picking up a stick and going shooting up this and shooting up that, or doing this and doing that. Music is an instruction book that put to a beat. So imagine deciphering your songs to your children or your future kids, because music is going to be around.
And you said music is an instruction book.
Put to a beat.
Put to a beat. So, let that one marinate. That made me need to marinate, though. You know, because people be letting airplanes go over their head of things that they really don't want to allow into their mind, because it'd be too real, too factual.
Yeah, it's pretty, you know, like, I don't want to keep going. I've talked a lot. I've ran sis around the Mulberry Bush, and I know she's tired, and I'm hungry. Auntie ready to do some other stuff. Lee's ready to do some other stuff, so I'm going to let y'all go. Y'all can holler at me on Instagram, at Big Homie Rum. You know, you can ask me questions. You know, holler at me. I got verses for the low. I need you to go check out my two artists, India's Only, and Slim Trotty. I can't remember his Instagram, but his name's Slim Trotty. Hit me up and I'll direct you to him. You know, thanks for the homegirl for having me here. Mama Boo. I'm down here at Auntie Sylvia Nunn location. I forgot what's it called, Auntie?
Okay.
Yeah, Sylvia's Angels.
Sylvia Nunn's Angels.
Like, y'all motherfuckers get down here. We're sending some donations to Auntie, because she deserve it, and you know the community need it. You know what I'm saying? Y'all know who I am. If you don't know who I am, you can Wikipedia me, look me up on Instagram, YouTube. Just type my name up on the internet. You know what I'm saying? So all you pop rules out there that want to pay homage to the city and want to do this and do that and sue whoops and all that, Sylvia Nunn's Angels.
And live your life coming soon. Right here, same location. But what I will do is I will leave all his information down in the link below. So if you guys got to do, just click on it to send you directly to his IG, and you guys can go from there. And I will, you have the YouTube channel as well, right?
Yeah.
So I will have that down below too. So you guys can link and, you know, just click the link and go on over there. And until next time, you guys, thank you for checking out Intimate Talk with Mama Boo with the legendary Red Rum. And we out of here, you guys.
Look at these niggas with attitude.
Hello, I started this gangster shit, and this the motherfucking thanks I get.
Hello,
I started this gangster shit, and this the motherfucking thanks I get.
Hello,
the motherfucking world is a ghetto, full of magazines, full clips and heavy metal. When the smoke settles, I'm just looking for a big yellow.